الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما بقية الله في الأراضين روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Brothers and sisters, inshallah, the first part of our talk will be on verse number 26 from the surah. Verse number 26. So this part of the verse is the statement of the girl who went back with Musa, went back to get Musa the first time, and then walked Musa back to her father's house. In the father's house, we know where we are in the story, in the father's house, a conversation takes place. Shu'aib alayhi salam asks Musa what the story was, what happened, what brought you here, what went on. And Musa alayhi salam explained to him the story. When Musa explained the story, then he told Musa not to be afraid. You're safe from the oppressive people. You're here now. This place is outside of the domain of Fir'aun. So now, the next part of the conversation starts. Inshallah, if Allah gives tawfiq, if I'm still alive, tomorrow we'll also maybe talk about a little bit about this part of the her conversation and the parenting style of Hazrat Shu'aib, the leadership style of Hazrat Shu'aib. There's some lessons to be learned in even this statement that she's making, but I want to focus on what she did, what she actually said in this particular session, inshallah. قالت. So who's speaking? The daughter of Shu'aib. قالت. إحداهما. The Quran just says one of the two. But we learn from a hadith that the one who went back was that same, we learned that she's the same sister here. قالت إحداهما. So one of the two said, يا أبتي. She spoke very respectfully to her father. O father, استأجره. Hire him. Hire this young man. Employ him. Inna khayra man ista'jarta al-qawiyyul amin. He says that the best person for you to hire, if you're going to hire somebody, the best person to hire is somebody who is qawi, strong. We'll call it capable also. Qawi means strong. But somebody who's capable, somebody who's strong, and al-amin, the person who's trustworthy. The best person you can hire is somebody who is strong, capable, and trustworthy. And please hire this young man. Now, part of the discussion is this. How did she know that he was trustworthy? They say that as far as her knowing how she was strong, that was because she had seen him handling that bucket. Remember where we are in the story that he came over there? And the shepherds were taking advantage of the girls. They were stronger. They were able to take care of their business. So Musa went forward and took the bucket from the girls. And he went over and he got water from them. So she saw his physical strength there. She knows he's qawi. He's strong. He's capable. But how did she know he was amin, trustworthy? They said this is from walking back. Well, it was more than that. According to Allama Tabatabai, not just the walk back, but also the walk back, that was important. So what happened? One of them, and this is again lessons for us, because all of us, brothers and sisters, we're trying to remind ourselves of what it is that Allah wants from us, how we're supposed to behave, how we're supposed to promote Islam when we're away from Muslim countries. So what happens is that the word amana, which means trust, here we find it being used in a bit of a larger sense than we might normally use it. How? Right now, the amana that's being referred to is the relationship between genders. He's amin in that way. He's trustworthy in that way. Not just that when you give him $20, he returns you the $20, but in his interactions with the opposite gender, he behaves in a fashion that is worthy of him being called amin and trustworthy. How? So part of it is the initial conversation that took place between him and the girls. He spoke in a very nice way. Of course, he's chivalrous. They're not mahram to him. He's chivalrous. What's the problem? What's the issue? How can I help? He goes over, he takes these things. So it's easy to pick up from the way that somebody communicates, the way that their eyes are, the way that they're talking. When they're talking to a non-mahram, it's easy to pick up how much of a, this person should be considered ameen. More than that. So part of it, she sees in that interaction with him that this young man is a man of values. It's not just anytime I get a chance to talk to somebody who's not my mahram, now I'm flirting, now I'm being ways that a mu'min shouldn't be. No. Very respectful of himself, of her, others. More than that. They said that for the way back, Musa doesn't know where Shu'aib lives. Nabi Shu'aib has invited them to come to the house. Musa doesn't know where that is. So the girl, she came here, her father sent her, very wonderful girl, very much herself, somebody's mu'mina, very good sister. This sister, she's leading the way. So my father sent me to invite you, and now I'm leading the way. So normally, because you don't know the way, you have to follow that person. They said, Musa told her, he was like, sister, I want you to walk behind me and tell me where the way is. We are a group of people. We don't look at women from the rear, that we're looking, the woman's walking, we're looking. No, we don't do that. We're people, we'll go ahead, and you'll tell me, you'll say that, brother, turn to the right, turn to the left, but I don't want to be following, you're walking and I'm looking, I don't like that. So from that, she knew that he was ameen, from that behavior. Not just words, actions. Way of speaking, way of talking, looking, and then saying that, look, we're a group of people, we're so chivalrous, we don't look at women, now I'm alone with a young woman, I'm looking, right? No, he's like that. So what I want to do now is kind of remind ourselves, based on the three things that we found in this verse, of some of our values. Sometimes there's values that we know about, we believe in, we just need a little bit of reminding. Otherwise, we know these are values. We know these. This is Islam wants us to be like this. It's not like somebody's giving us necessarily new information. I remember hearing once, they said that there was an elderly couple. And the old man met this old lady, both of them widower. And he was very impressed with the old lady. And he told the old lady, he said, you know, I'd like to marry you. Alhamdulillah. And the old lady immediately said, yes. So the old man was very happy, alhamdulillah, and he went home. Then when he went home, he started to think about it. He was like, what was the answer? I told her that I wanted to get married to her, but I'm so old, I don't even remember what her answer was. Did she say yes? I think she said yes. But no, maybe she looked at me kind of funny, I'm not sure. So old man was there, and he was agonizing over it. Did she say yes? Did she say no? What was the thing? So finally he decided to call the old lady. He was really embarrassed. And he called the old lady, and he told the old lady, he said that, look, I'm really, really embarrassed. I know I proposed to you, but I don't remember what you told me. And the old lady said, I'm so happy that you called. I know I said yes to somebody, I just didn't remember who. So sometimes what happens, we might not remember our values. We want to remind ourselves again and again. This is good for the spiritual process, the idea of us being reminded about our values. So now, some of the things that we find in this verse as reminders. She's describing Musa, right? Inna. خَيْرَ مَنَ اسْتَأْجَرْتَ الْقَوِيُّ الْأَمِينَ. The best person you can hire is the person who is strong and trustworthy. Powerful and trustworthy. We'll say capable also, so that we can apply this more to ourselves. So the first point is the idea of not being satisfied with being mediocre. She said the best person, خَيْرَ مَنَ اسْتَأْجَرْتَ. She's talking about Musa. She's talking about the general principle. The general principle is the best person to hire is this person. The example, the misdaq, is Musa. That Musa was the best person you could hire. Not an average person. Not a mediocre person. And I feel like this is a good reminder for all of us. Of course, starting with myself, the idea of not being satisfied with just being ordinary, average. Some people float through life. They don't have that higher motivation to be somebody who's excellent in whatever it is that they do. But what we learn from the prophetic teachings is that as believers, we should be excellent. It shouldn't be the case that we're just average, we're just like everybody else. No, the believer should stand out in the crowd. The police should be excellent at whatever it is that they do. We have that story, famous story, well-known meaning. It's in the, we find that the Prophet saw that the believers, they had made a grave for someone. Apparently this is the son of the Prophet, so somebody's made a grave for his son. Now when the Prophet's looking at the grave, the Prophet notices that there's one area of the grave that hasn't been fixed properly. So the Prophet went over and he straightened that with his hand. And he made this statement. He said, إِذَا عَمِلَ أَحَدُكُمْ عَمَلًا, whenever one of you does something, whatever one of you does something, فَلْيُتْقِن, he should do it right. He should do it well. One of you, even if something as simple as doing a grave, but do it professionally, do it properly. Not the idea that because I'm a mu'min, these things don't matter. No, the mu'min excellence. Right? The best person you could hire at that time was Musa. The best person others could interact with would be us as believers. The best at our jobs, the best in education, right? The best motivation for us. Now, why is it that sometimes we as believers, what is it that keeps us from being those people who can promote the message of the Imam in the most effective manner? What keeps us from achieving our true potential? Us as believers, what's part of the reason that the Imam's not here? What traits do we have to work on? Well, one of the things that may keep us back from achieving our true potential is laziness. Why aren't you excellent? I just don't have the energy to do that. I don't have the motivation to do that. Many times you'll find there's believers, mu'mineen and mu'minat, but we go through life, we're not achieving, we're not doing all that we could do. We're just kind of floating, we're going through, we're moving, alhamdulillah. Right? Whereas the expectation for us as soldiers of the Imam, inshallah, will be somebody who's excellent. So why not? What happens is laziness. And sometimes that happens in the generation that we're in right now. Things have been made easy for us. Life is easier for us than those who were before us. Sometimes we don't take advantage of that though. Instead of us doing more than those who went before us, now we do less. Life's even easier now. So we have a hadith that Allah hates the person who's lazy. Allah yubghidhu sahih al-farigh. In this hadith it says Allah hates the healthy person who's unoccupied. What do you do all day? Nothing. They said once there was this young man. So they asked him, they said, what are you doing? Oh, he said, I'm working. I'm with my uncle. They said, well, what does your uncle do? He said, he's not working either. We hang out together. Right? That kind of, no. The idea of the mu'min, the believer, like God doesn't like to see the person who has nothing to do on their hands. Unoccupied. The hadith continues. It says, لَا فِي شُغْلِ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا فِي شُغْلِ الْآخِرَةِ. Not doing something for the dunya, not doing something for the hereafter. I'm relaxed. It's okay. I don't do anything. There's no reason. By the way, this doesn't, when we talk about the idea of occupations and making sure we're working and we're doing things, it doesn't mean that we're not saying that being a housewife isn't a job, right? That's a job. That's a full-time job. We don't want to say, okay, alhamdulillah, God says go over, so every Muslim woman run out and get a job. No, that is a job, right? If our wives are working, they're working two jobs. Our wives are working, they're working two jobs. But that is a job. Now, our thing though is the idea of being excellent in whatever we're doing. We don't want to blame God for our own mistakes. So sometimes when I don't experience God's best, when I don't see all those barakat, all those blessings of being a true soldier of the Imam, preparing for the Imam of the time. Let's say even, we can bring it to other areas. I'm struggling in my relationship with my spouse. I'm struggling in my relationship at work. I'm not being promoted, for instance. I'm not doing well at school. I'm not doing well with my parents. Sometimes what happens, people who are lazy, I'll blame it on God. Right? Allah didn't want this to happen, right? You know we have a hadith about that? This beautiful hadith from Imam Ali alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He says, beware and take full precaution, and yakhda'aka shaytan, lest Satan fool you. Take full precaution, lest Satan fool you. How? فَيُمَثِّلْ لَكَ التَّوَانِي فِي سُورَةِ التَّوَكُّلِ. Shaitan show you weakness as tawakkul. I'm not doing my job properly. I'm not making that full effort, let's say in my house, with my spouse. I'm not doing all that I could to make our relationship better, but I'll blame it on God. Why did God's afflicting me and now I just have to have patience? Well, brother, well, sister, well, maybe you need to make a little effort to better the relationship. Why is it that I haven't gotten the promotion? Well, they're prejudiced against Muslims. Yahud, they're Yahud. Right? Maybe I'm not working. Maybe I'm not making effort, right? So Imam Ali warns us against the idea. He continues, he says, he make you to suffer humiliation by blaming it on qadar and qadha, right? That this is the decree of Allah. God wanted it to be that way. He said, then he tells us a proper way of doing tawakkul, Imam Ali does. The proper way of tawakkul is making full effort, doing everything that I can, and then leaving it in God's hands. From the beginning to the end, it's tawakkul. From the beginning to end, it's in God's hands. But I'm making that full effort with tawakkul. He says, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ بِالتَّوَكُّلِ. God has commanded you to do tawakkul. He says, عِنْدَ انْقِطَاعِ الْحِيَلِ وَالتَّسْلِيمْ لِلْقَضَىٰ بَعْدَ الْإِعْذَارِ. So he says that God has told you to submit to that divine degree after you've tried all efforts. You've done everything. You've done your part. Now, yes, I can say fully that tawakkul, I rely on Allah, I leave it in God's hands. After making full effort, then I submit to the qadha of Allah. Not just that I sit back from the beginning and I blame God. Right? So this is the second reason why we might not be achieving our full potential. One could be that actually I'm lazy. One could be a lack of understanding about the idea of tawakkul, and I'm not doing that properly. I haven't put my full effort into getting it what it is that I want. And, of course, we don't want to fall in the other trap of kind of thinking that it's all on us either. Right? I'm the one who makes this happen. No, from the beginning to the end, it's tawakkul. What else? Even ibadah is not an excuse for being lazy and not making full effort and not pulling our own weight. Different ways, what we're doing, discussing different ways. Why is it that sometimes as a believer, as a mu'min, me, you, us, mu'mini, mu'minat, are not those true soldiers of the Imam of the time? Where might Shaitan strike? Might he come in? Sometimes my excuse could be one of those first two things. Sometimes my excuse might be ibadah, worship of Allah. That instead of me knowing that I can make everything into ibadah by making a correct niyyah, when I'm going to work, it's ibadah. We talked about the hadith yesterday. When I'm going to school, I make it ibadah. When I'm interacting with my spouse, I make it ibadah. Instead of me doing that, sometimes I think of ibadah only as being rituals. So there was a man, they came into the presence of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. These people arrived, let's say in Medina, and they're speaking to the Prophet, and they said, we went on this trip with this one individual and we haven't seen anybody better than this individual. So the Prophet says, you know, so they start describing, they start telling, what's the story? What was so good about this person? He says, every time we would stop our animals, back in the day when they would travel, be traveling with animals, right, with camels or whatever, so they would stop in a certain area. He said, as soon as we would stop, this person, this brother, would take out his prayer rug and he would start to make salah and worship, ibadah. So the Prophet asked, he said, well, who would gather, who would take care of the animals? Who would get the firewood? Who would take it? He said, oh, the little things? We took care of those things. This guy, mashallah, always ibadah, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet said these words. He says, kullukum afdal minhu. All of you are better than that person. He doesn't carry his own weight, everything in the name of ibadah. I don't even do my own responsibilities. I don't perform my takleef. I put it all on other people. No, I'm worshiping. What I'm doing is really holy. What other people are doing, that's menial. That kind of an approach, no, that's not the Islamic approach for getting to those highest levels of qurbah and getting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything in its proper place. It doesn't mean neglecting ibadah, by the way. It doesn't mean relying only on ourselves and not on Allah, thinking we're the ones who makes it happen. No. But the idea of I blame everything on God, I do my part, and my part is simply to perform acts of worship. That part is the part that I'm saying is incorrect. So what happens is that, now, let's say we have other people. So one part of it could be that act of laziness, right? So what we're talking about in the verse is the idea that Musa was the best person you could hire. And the idea of us as believers being the best in whatever it is that we do. Whatever it is that we're doing, we want to do it properly. What happens for some people is that they go to the opposite extreme. They're the best, but the motivation is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's some people, I'm at the top of my career. I am making more money than anybody else. I am the best doctor. I am, right? I'm doing the best. But my motivation for this wasn't lillah. So I'm doing very well from a dunyawi point of view. If you come and you see this brother or this sister, you're like, well, you have it all. Alhamdulillah, mashallah. But in reality, this person hasn't done these things. Is not khair in the law. Allah doesn't, if he was going to give a grade, he wouldn't say this person is doing the best for me. That balance isn't there. So sometimes that's what happens. So sometimes my motivation, let's say we'll start with niyya. My motivation, why is it that you're the best at your job? The best, right? I'm afraid I'll get kicked out of my job. I'm afraid I'll become obsolete. I take on more work than I should. I'm working more hours than I should because I'm so afraid the company will downsize. I know now that I'm working so many hours, actually my personal relationship with my spouse is now compromised. But I'm so terrified. I can't relax knowing that God is taking care of my rizq. So from an outward point of view, you see two people, one of them doing very well as far as their education or whatever it is, but the motivation isn't Allah. It's not bringing them any closer to God, this work. So what's important to us is the idea of whatever we're doing for Him. Whatever we're doing for Him. So even overworking without that right niyyah, yeah, that could be problematic. That could be the reason that I am holding back the cause of the imam. I'm neglecting my children. I always bring work home. I'm taking care of work. I get my assignments done on time, alhamdulillah. But I don't play with my kids. I don't have time to talk to my wife. They say that a man, before he gets married, everything his wife, he's getting to know the girl, right? Everything she says, he'll think about it all night, right? But they said once he gets married, his wife's still talking, he falls asleep. So sometimes what happens, I'm not making room for what's important. My children are important, my wife, my spouse, myself, my worship, my ibadah. It's the month of Ramadan, how much Quran have I read? Other than the month of Ramadan, how much Quran am I reading? I'm a mu'min, I'm a believer, I'm not like everybody else. In order for me to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have to be focusing on everything in the right way. So some guidance for us in this regard. One of the things that we learn from the path of the Ahlul Bayt is that even when we're seeking our provision, our rizq, right? I'm trying to look to provide for my family, which is a duty. Us men, we have to be out there, we're working, we're providing, we're looking for our families. Some sisters are providing for their families, right? Might be a case, a sister's working, taking care of herself, or she's not even married, she's providing. How much should I work? When is it that I say, no, now I'm compromising on my quality of life. Now it's too much. Now it's not getting me closer to Allah. Yes, work is ibadah, but how much work? What we learn from some of the ahadith is the idea of balance, of balance. So let me share with you this one hadith from Imam Sadiq, salamullahi alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. He says, liyakun talabuka lil ma'isha fawqa kasbil mudayya wa duna talabil haris. He says, when you're seeking provision, you're seeking rizq, you're trying to earn money, he said, you shouldn't be like the person who's negligent, but it should be less than the person who's haris and greedy. Middle path. So I do my work well. We learned that from the Prophet, that first hadith. Whatever I do well.
But do I go all out? I spend every... No. Not like the person who's greedy. Not under. And not negligent so that I'm not doing my work properly. I believe risk is in God's hand. God provides. I do my part and I do it well. So that part is actually very important for us, and we want to make sure that we're doing that. The next part, brothers and sisters, is the idea of, I talked about the idea of not being lazy, and I talked about even the relationship with the spouse or children, right? Or inshallah, children trying to be good to their parents, right? Let's say I'm a child and up until now, I haven't really been as respectful as I should have been. When I look back and I review my actions, I don't see that I'm honoring and venerating my parents the way I should be, right? So even a child who's doing this, who's trying to apply these principles for themselves. What else though? The next point is the idea of not being mediocre when it comes to spirituality. Sometimes it's easy for me to find motivation to be excellent at work. I want to be excellent at work. Excellent at school, right? But what about my motivation to be above and beyond when it comes to getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Our successes, brothers and sisters, know this because you're part of the global movement that's preparing the world for the return of the Imam. The Imam is waiting on you and I, mu'mineen and mu'minat, to come back to Islam, to implement God's teachings without the Imam being present, that he has enough of that critical mass that then Allah gives him permission to do khuruj and to come back and to do qiyam. Now, when you're looking all around the world, you'll see pockets of mu'mineen everywhere. Sometimes you'll find countries. You'll find Bahrain Muslims and mu'mineen standing up over there. You'll find in Iraq, you'll find in Iran, you'll find in India, you'll find in Pakistan, people coming back to Islam. In Europe, in America, mu'mineen, mu'mina. And it's sometimes so impressive when you hear these stories of believers. How did you even come to Islam? Sometimes people are new Muslims. What brought you to this wonderful religion? And then you see that motivation, right? And you get inspired by it. Now, what happens is, our success globally, wherever it is that we are, has not been only how clever we are, although we mu'mineen are talented. It's not only been how hardworking we are and we're good at our jobs. Our success, brothers and sisters, has come many times through our relationship with Allah. So we've implemented those things. We've gone back to original Islam, which meant I had to work hard, which meant I had to be excellent. But I've done it for the sake of God. For the sake of God. And that's been what's given us success. So, what about my spirituality? What about being a better mu'min, a better believer? What about being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? One of my favorite stories that I'd like to share with you is about someone, a young man who became shaheed. Became shaheed. So when this young man became shaheed, the people went over to his body and they noticed a piece of paper in his jacket, in his clothing. They took out that piece of paper from his clothing, and on that piece of paper was written, sins of the week. There's a spiritual process called al-muhasabah. Al-muhasabah means that we take account of ourselves. Instead of me just going through life, going through the motions, those people who are looking for the higher levels of Islamic spirituality and irfan, they do what we call al-muhasabah. I take account of myself. So this individual had written down his sins of the week, al-muhasabah. So he goes over, they start reading this now from this young man. He's dead. He's passed away. He's gone to Allah. What are his sins of the week? It says, Saturday, feeling proud after scoring a goal against the opposing team. We were playing, let's say, soccer. I scored a goal, but then I felt a sense of pride. Ghurur, for instance. That was his sin for Saturday. Sunday, what was the sin? He looked over all of his things. No Muharram, alhamdulillah, no haram. What was the sin? I finished Salatul Layl quickly. I made Salatul Layl, but I normally would take a bit more time. This time I finished Salatul Layl quickly. Monday, what was the sin? He said, I forgot. I used to always make a sajda of shukr. I forgot my sajda of shukr. So Monday, that was the sin that I committed, my mistake. Tuesday, what was the sin? He says, the sin is I went to sleep without wudu. It's recommended for us before we go to bed to make wudu, to sleep with wudu. He says, I didn't do any sins. The sin I committed, the mistake I made, was that I went to bed without wudu. He said, Wednesday, what happened? He says, Wednesday, there was a large group of us. We were laughing. There was a group. And I was laughing. And I laughed really, really loud. right? Laughing in a loud voice. That was my mistake for Wednesday. Thursday, what happened? He says, Thursday, the commander of the entire the troops, he came by and he passed salams to me before I passed salams to him, because it's better for us to be the first one to pass salams. He first was the first one to pass salams. He says, Friday, what did I do wrong? He said, Friday, I only did 800 salawat. Normally I would do maybe 1,000. Friday, all I did was 800. This guy, his name was Husseini, he was in the ninth grade. In the ninth grade. So the idea of us not being satisfied with our own spirituality that, well, you know, alhamdulillah, I do the wajibat. Wajibat is bare minimum, brothers and sisters. We're talking about becoming elite soldiers of the Imam of the time. That means spiritual ambition. Not struggling to get in the door. Spiritual ambition. I'm trying to be the best of the soldiers of the Imam. I'm trying to get close to him. I'm trying to go on the spiritual path. So, that's one of the points. So we'll take that and we'll move now back again to the verse. So the second lesson that we want to get from the verse. The second lesson that we want to get from the verse was her description of who was the best person to hire. Musa was the best person to hire, but she said, why? Why is it that Musa was somebody who her father should be hiring? He said, إِنَّ خَيْرَ مَنَ اسْتَعْجَرْتَ الْقَوِيُّ الْأَمِينَ. The best person you can hire is that person who's qawi and amin, physically strong. Physically strong. Qawi is strong. Actually, brothers and sisters, this is another area that I feel sometimes has been ignored by us mu'mineen and mu'minat. Sometimes we don't know the emphasis that Islam has put on us actually being physically strong, being in shape. Islam has put emphasis. We find when we look, we speak to our ulama, our senior ulama. One time, Ayatollah Khamenei was speaking. He said that there's three things that I want from the youth. Three things I want from the youth. He said one of them is education. Right? If somebody is in school, that they take advantage of that. We want this information in Muslim brains. He said the other one was purification of the soul. Not just that I'm trying to do my wajib, I'm trying to purify my heart of my... He said the third one is exercise. Right? So we have that in that exercise and these things. So by the way, I'm going to talk a little bit about being physically in shape because that's important. But this is separate from the idea of having healthy self, a healthy self-image. Sometimes what happens, because we're in a society which is so much about the zahir, so much about your outward looks, how you look, what your shape is, what your size is, sometimes we might get these two confused. That I judge, I have a healthy self-image, for instance, if I'm very much in shape, and if I'm not, or I don't look the way they say I should look, then I don't have that healthy self-image. So that's another mistake. The believer should have a healthy self-image. We're mu'mineen. We're followers of Ahlul Bayt. What greater gift than that? Right? So we're not talking about, we're going to talk about being healthy and being in shape, that's right. But is it that if I'm not in shape, for instance, that means I feel bad about myself because society will make comments and they will judge? No, that's not what we want to talk about. So the first one, before I get into I am going to concentrate on the physical exercise because sometimes we don't hear it enough from the minbar. Actually, this is one of the beautiful things about us as Shia of Amirul Mu'mineen. One of the beautiful things is that we'll gather here for majalis. Because of the sacrifices of Ahlul Bayt, we will come, people are traveling, something like 45, an hour, over an hour, to come here just to hear a few words of Quran and Sunnah, to recite the Holy Quran, because of the sacrifice of Amirul Mu'mineen. This is one of our advantages, that we will participate in such gatherings. But sometimes in such gatherings, if we're not told about some of our responsibilities, then we don't take them obviously as being responsibilities. Okay, so now, the first one is about the idea of the self-image and not judging myself based on my looks. Right? Based on my looks. Rather, I want to have that healthy self-image no matter how I look. Okay, so the first question will be this. How does one rebuild their self-image? Let's say I'm somebody who was tormented by others or made fun of or not the approved race, right? Sometimes it happens, by the way, sometimes even when people come here, they immigrate from other countries, sometimes what happens is some people in the bottom of their heart, they kind of want to be white. Right? Sometimes. Not all mu'mineen and mu'minat, but sometimes people who are from other places, they judge themselves, right? Like even amongst the African Americans before, they used to have the paper bag test. Right? They used to make fun of people who were dark. Right? So sometimes it happens that I see the way God wants me to see myself. Very important. Three quick steps. Obviously, we don't have all of the time in the world to cover these things. But the thing is that one can have a healthy self-image even if one isn't the ideal. There was a woman, she was not even a Muslim actually. Not even a Muslim. She used to work, so it was a woman, working in an all-male department, right? So sisters would definitely understand this. There's a woman who's working in an all-male department. This woman, she's a believer in God though, one of her legs was actually shorter than the other, right? So normally, everybody's gonna look at you based on how you look and these things, and she has this advantage. I can't even fix that. One of my legs is actually short, and she had the healthiest self-image. Other people may be making fun of her. No, God help them. They have a problem. So how can we have that? How can we develop that healthy, very important for us, to develop in our children, to develop in ourselves? The first one is the idea of realizing and recognizing that we are the best of Allah's creation. We human beings are the best of Allah's creation. The greatest of Allah's creation. The verses of Quran, one of them, it says, لَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. We have honored Bani Adam. This is very different, by the way, to what you see in the movies. If you see in the movies, one of the things is that they focus on this idea of evolution, and then they talk about the idea of artificial intelligence, right? Others even being more advanced to us than us, right? Well, we're the best of creation. We're told in a hadith, it says that they asked the imam, they said, are we better or the malaika? Are we better or the malaika? And the imam told him, he said, well, it depends how you use your talents. He says, either. He says, because you've been given aql, you've been given intelligence, and shahwa, lust. Aql. He says, the malaika only have aql. They don't have lust in the hadith. They don't have lust. He says, the animals only have lust. They don't have aql. So he says, if as a human being, your aql overcomes your lusts, you're in connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, you're even better than the malaika. But if I'm the opposite way, that my nafs, my lust overcome me, even worse than the animals. Brothers and sisters, we can be worse than the shayateen also. Sometimes the cruelty that human beings will dish out on one another, the stories that people, what people have done to one another, are so shameful. What human being? We are the greatest of Allah's creation. If God forbid we turn it the other way, we can be hell on wheels. Or we can be the best. So we're the best of Allah's creation, of course, if we implement. So just keeping that in mind, one point. Next one. When we're judging ourselves, what do we judge ourselves by? When I want to look back at my life and I want to say that I'm successful or not successful, do I say, look, what kind of car I drive? How big my house is? Which neighborhood I'm in? Do I have power lunches? Huh? Some people are so shallow, they judge themselves on these things. How much education? You know, sometimes divine blessings become ni'mah. There's some people, for instance, Allah has given them the blessing of secular education, the blessing. They use that now to become arrogant. I'm talking to my spouse and then I tell my spouse, you can't understand me, you don't have a PhD. I'm such a shallow person. I'm judging myself on a gift. That makes me a better person? You can't understand me? There are people who are that shallow. Money, how much money I make. So if I'm a person who's shallow, so let's go back though. What's the divine way? This is now for the brothers and sisters who are trying to pave the way for the return of the Mahdi. What are our values? What is God's values, not their values? إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The person who is the most noble in God's eyes is the person who has the most taqwa. Not the biggest house, not the most money. Divine values, ilm. Service in the way of God, jihad, right? Divine values. Those are the things we want to be judging ourselves on or moving in the right direction. Whatever blessing Allah has given me, that I use it in that way. So that's the second one, which is very important. The other one is being happy with the way that God made us. God made us. God's the one who designed us. I'm happy with God's gift to me. God's gift to me. They have a hadith that tell us that when the Prophet would look and he would see his reflection, he used to say these words, Alhamdulillahilladhi akmala khalqi wa ahsana surati. Rough translation. All praise is due to Allah who made my creation perfect and made my face beautiful. I'm happy with the way I look. This is God's gift to me. I don't want to be somebody else. I don't wish I was something else. Now, I shared this in another community, and I felt like some of the people got a little uncomfortable when I said what I'm about to say next. So I don't want anybody to freak out or run out of the masjid or, you know, the sheikh has gone crazy. You know, relax, I'm here. Say it's here also. Alhamdulillah. Research. What we learned from some of the research on the actual, the Ahlul Bayt themselves, alayhimus salatu wasalam, is that the Ahlul Bayt came in different shapes and sizes. The Ahlul Bayt! Sometimes, and I don't see it in your center here, people have pictures of what they think Imam Ali looked like, what they think Hazrat Abbas looked like, right? But what did they actually look like? What did Musa look like? Right? We have a hadith that tell us the description of these individuals. So for instance now brace yourselves, okay? For instance, one of the things, and this doesn't mean, by the way, that the Ahlul Bayt weren't good looking, that they weren't handsome, right? But for instance, Imam Hussein, you've heard this story, Imam Hussein, his beard went gray early, right? Imam Hussein, he had dyed his beard. One of the stories, which you all know, I'm not going to get into the details of it, but Imam Hussein had dyed his beard. He said, hey, the man said that he saw his beard and was like, you know, the wing of a raven, for instance, the feather. He was like, is that really? He said, no, we became gray early. Our beard went white early, right? More than that, Imam Ali alayhi salam, Imam Ali, according to some of the ahadith, multiple traditions, was balding. To the extent that in some of the ahadith, they said that we had read about the person who was the wasi, and we were told that he was that person who was asla. And the imam took off his helmet and he said, it's me. Right? So instead of fear as a man, I'm panicking, why is it? I'm losing hair. Midlife crisis. More than that, some of the a'imma were very dark, right? Some of us, we, you know, sometimes even with sisters, sometimes, God forbid, this in some families, they'll be like, if the girl's very fair skinned, then she's pretty. Huh? It's in there in some cultures. The Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam, right? So when it comes to Imam Hassan Askari, they said he was asmar, brown. Imam al-Jawad was very dark according to some of the ahadith. They said, you've heard the stories that they even doubted, really, you're from Imam Ridha? Right? It doesn't mean the Imam wasn't handsome. Right? Doesn't mean the Imam wasn't handsome. Right? So keep these things in mind. Instead of us, you know, I wish I was something else. No, I'm happy to be who I am. Allah made me in this way. More than that, some of the Imams were actually big boned. There's a story from Shahid Mutahari. I've read the hadith itself, but I'm telling you, you know, Shaykh's gone crazy. No, Shahid Mutahari. I've read the hadith itself. I have the hadith here. But they said they went to go see Imam al-Baqir. He's walking and he sees the Imam, and the Imam's working in the field. The Imam's working in the field, and the Imam's sweating. He says the Imam was leaning on two individuals. There were two other people who were there working. The Imam's leaning on these individuals. And he says, وَكَانَ رَجُلًا بَادِنًا ثَقِيلًا. The Imam was a heavyset person. The Imam was heavyset. We come in different shapes and sizes. I should be this shape, I should be that size, otherwise I feel bad about myself. No. Different shapes and sizes, all beautiful, all wonderful, all creation of God. Right? What is that hadith we learned from the Prophet? Where the Prophet said that Allah made my creation, He made my face beautiful, God designed me. Right? So we say, if we're going to translate it to layman's English, you know, all praise is due to Allah who made me a handsome devil. Alhamdulillah, Allah made me this way. So, now, the next thing is that an excuse now not to be in shape? Because that was what we were talking about. We said that the verse was, the best person to hire was the person who was al-qawi al-amin. Al-qawi al-amin. So, when we're talking about the person who's qawi, who's physically strong, that's also something that we want to focus on. There's not an excuse for any of us, brothers and sisters, not to be doing exercise, regular exercise. We're all supposed to have this in our life, regular exercise. As mu'mineen, lillah, for the sake of God. Regular exercise, very important. What happens is, that if we look back at some of our forefathers, I'm talking about one generation, two generations before us, we'll see that sometimes the generation before us was more healthy than 40-year-olds now. The generation before, 80 years old and still going very strong, right? They had regular physical activity. Whereas now, sometimes I sit in my car has air conditioning, I don't even need natural air. When I go to the parking lot, I keep circling the parking lot. I don't even want to walk from the car to the store. I want to get close as possible. No exercise. So what happens, brothers and sisters, we have to make up for this by physical exercise. Us, me and you. Parents have to make this something that their children do. My children are very good, alhamdulillah. They stay quiet and they play video games, alhamdulillah. They don't bother me. Whenever they start to bother me, I buy a new video game, and again they're quiet, alhamdulillah. Physical exercise, children getting outside. Is it time for adhan? Oh, okay, afwan. Okay, so exercise. So let me just show you the hadith, we'll move quickly because there's something else that we need to talk about too. So the hadith is this. Right, one of the hadith. So emphasis from the ulama, right? But one of the hadith. They said that I went and I saw Imam al-Qadhim alayhi salam, and he was working in the field. Right? Imam al-Qadhim. Arif billah, we can't even imagine his spiritual status, working physically with his hands. So I asked the Imam, Aina rijal? Where are the men? Why don't you have servants? Somebody should be doing this. You're Imam. Arif billah, you working in the field? Listen to the words of the Imam. He says, قَدْ عَمِلَ بِالْيَدِ مَنْ هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِنِّي فِي أَرْضِهِ وَمِنْ أَبِيهِ. He says that people who were better than me and better than my father worked in the field with their hands, physical labor, physically active. The person says, who? He said, Rasulullah, Amirul Mu'mineen, Abai alayhim as-salam, kulluhum, all of the Ahlul Bayt, kulluhum. He said, قَدْ عَمِلُوا بِأَيْدِيهِمْ. They were all working with their hands. They all had a physical lifestyle. Brothers and sisters, if we want to become those soldiers of the Imam, all of Islam, everything Islam says, everybody working with their hands. And he says, this is, huwa min amali an-nabiyyin wal-mursaleen wal-awliya wal-salihin. He says, the righteous people did this, the salihin. Prophets did this, mursaleen, right? Everybody would be working. So brothers and sisters, if we don't have that as part of our routine, we have to make sure that, no, that is part of our routine, to actually keep ourselves and our families in shape. Right? And our families in shape. By the way, also, if a man wants his wife to shape up, right, that's one of her responsibilities also. Right? He would like his wife to get in shape, and then that's also one of her responsibilities. We want to keep that in mind. Ayatollah Khamenei, right, as busy as he is, right, he's like 76 now, I believe, Ayatollah Khamenei. You know which exercise he does on a weekly basis? Some of his bodyguards telling the story. They said, either 1.5 hours of 2 hours of exercise, hiking in the mountains, 76 years old. How busy, and he is so busy, right? He's running a country, fighting in Syria, and helping out in Iraq, and helping out in Bahrain, right? And he still makes time for exercise. So me and you, we can't make excuses. We can't say I'm too old to exercise. We can't say I'm too busy. Right? Everybody needs to be doing this. Now, the last point, inshallah, and then we'll conclude, inshallah, hopefully if Allah gives tawfiq, we'll mention a little bit about Amirul Mu'mineen. This last point, brothers and sisters, is about the idea of the last trait that she described for Imam Ali. She said, not for Imam Ali, for Musa. She said, the best person to hire, she said, hire him, Father. The best person you can hire, خَيْرَ مَنْ اسْتَأْجَرْتَ الْقَوِيُّ الْأَمِينَ. The person who is Amin and trustworthy. Amin. Now what we learn is that actually when the hadith from Ahlul Bayt tell us, they say, let's say you want to know if somebody's really religious. How do we know if somebody, how do we know if we are really religious? How do we know if we're really religious? They tell us, don't be fooled by how many extra acts of worship the person does. Person always making salah, always giving khums, always doing these things. Alhamdulillah, those are wonderful things. But how do I know if you're really religious? If I'm really religious, let's not point fingers. Let's start with ourselves. They say, look for two things. One of them, does the person tell the truth? Does the person tell the truth? Secondly, is the person careful with amanat? Is the person trustworthy? Is the person amin? For instance, let's say at work, brothers and sisters, at work, how careful are we to make sure that if we're working for somebody, other people are finding ways to cheat at work and still get paid? Huh? Finding ways to do less. But as a mu'min, our Prophet was Amin and Sadiq. Amin and Sadiq. Not cheating, not lying, not stealing. So we want to make sure that we're like that. And what we learned from this thing, and I have to just wrap up now, is the idea that when they were talking about Amin, it wasn't only those outward trusts that you give me $100, I give you $100 back. How Amin am I when it comes to non-mahrams? How Amin am I when it comes to my looks? Not looking at what's forbidden, right? Musa. The way I speak when I'm talking to a non-mahram. How Amin am I in that, right? Musa, the story of Musa. Why was she calling him Amin? We talked about it from the beginning, right? So, I talked about the idea of hijab before. Well, iffah, chastity, right? So what happens is the rules, I covered some of the rules on looking before. So some of the rules we want to keep in mind. If a woman, I explained this before, that if a woman is a woman who observes the hijab, then we're not allowed except to look at her hands and her face, right? But let's say there's a woman who doesn't observe the hijab. She's free. Then what's the ruling? So different maraja have different rulings. We'll have to find out what their rulings are. Some of the maraja say that if there's a woman who doesn't wear the hijab, and if you tell her she's just, they say you can still only look at those areas that you're allowed to. So her face and her hands. You might see more than that, but you're not looking. You might see more than that, but you're not looking. So the same way, like you go into a store in the mall, and in the mall they're praying music which you're not allowed to listen to. There's one time I go in that store in the mall and then I'm dancing to the beat too. I'm enjoying it. Alhamdulillah. I'm glad I went in this store. Right? Another time, no. I'm not listening. I hear some of that. So now, if I'm not looking, but other marajis say no. If there's a woman who doesn't observe the hijab and doesn't respect herself in that way, she has the same ruling as the kuffar. The same ruling as the kuffar. The same way with the kuffar, you can look at those areas that they don't normally cover without lust, without fear of falling in sin. Those women also who do that, they have the same ruling. So that issue of hijab, also important. Amin, very important. Now, one last point, and that is the idea of, well now, what about the idea of recovering? Let's say I was looking at things which were forbidden. I wasn't careful with my eyes. I would lust when it came to non-mahrams. And by the way, sometimes with women also, because we have ayat of Quran about women being careful about their eyes too, and men, both. How can I recover? So first of all, it's completely possible to recover. We can become people who are, even if we weren't before. We can't go into that right now. We'll go a little bit into the story of Imam Ali. So how much time do we have, brother? We have 7 minutes. Okay. So brothers and sisters, now what we'd like to do is to mention a little bit about the story of the Imam. Right? Imam Ali, as we know, was the perfect example of all three traits. The Imam was the best. The Imam was the strongest. We've heard his stories. The Imam was the most trustworthy. Right? They used to say that when they would look at Imam Ali, even as a young man, by the way, As a young man, they used to say, whoever looked at him would say, Subhanallah, ma a'lam hadhal fata. How knowledgeable this young man is. Subhanallah, ma ashja'a. How brave this young man is. Subhanallah, ma afsah. How fasih. How eloquent this person is, right? So Imam Ali is that person who gets the most out of his God-given talents in those three areas and other areas. So now I'd like to talk a little bit about the amana of Ali. The amana of Ali. Okay. So, as we know, the Prophet left behind a very big trust for Ali. A very big trust for Ali. And the Prophet used to introduce his daughter, the Lady Fatima, sometimes in this way. They say, Kharaja Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ali, the Prophet came out. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.